Hi, this is AJ Hamilton with Red Carpet Report. We're here at UCLA celebrating the 41st annual Annie Awards.
Good, how are you?
Okay, I started this.
Yes, you did.
1972.
God.
Yep.
Wow. You've done so much for animation. It's incredible.
What animation has done for me.
What's up, docs and docettes? It's me, Trevor Thompson, the self-appointed Looney Tunes critic. And today is both a very happy and sad day. Recording this on July 27th, 2017, and it's the 77th anniversary of A Wild Hare, the cartoon that many animation historians and cartoon fans agree is the definitive first Bugs Bunny cartoon. And it's also a very sad day because animation lost somebody who was very important, and we're all very upset about it. So this is for June. June Foray, the voice of countless cartoon characters to have entertained over five generations, passed away this morning, just 54 days shy of what would have been her 100th birthday. Now, think about that. Over five generations. That means, depending on how old you are, June Foray was someone completely different to you. To the oldest generations, she was Granny, Witch Hazel, at two separate studios yet, Warner Brothers and Disney, and Rocky the Flying Squirrel, not to mention Natasha, on Rocky and His Friends. To a slightly younger generation, she was Grammy Gummy on Gummy Bears, Shitty Smurf on the Shitty Smurf Shit Show, and Magicka Dispel on DuckTales. By the way, I don't know how they're going to use this character in the reboot, but I would prefer it if they just didn't. And to the youngest generation, she's multiple voices on The Marvelous Misadventures of Flapjack, Mrs. Cauldron on The Garfield Show, for which she won her first Emmy, and Mama Sasquatch from The Legend of Sasquatch. Not to mention, she was Granny from almost the beginning. Granny's voice was originated by Betty Rubble actress Bee Benaderet, but June soon took over the role, even before the animation studio at Warner Brothers had shut down. So, she was original generation Granny, and kept doing it until recently. Granny appeared in stuff throughout the 70s and 80s, made appearances in Tiny Toon Adventures, is a main character in the Sylvester and Tweety Mysteries, which was generation Y2K, and on Baby Looney Tunes, which ran into 2005, not to mention video games and other multimedia, and plus, Granny was in multiple episodes of The Looney Tunes Show, which only stopped production 4 years ago. So yeah, she's all over the place. June has been at the forefront of many different forms of media at the height of their popularity. There were always movies for her to work on. It was video games recently, television before that, and in the beginning, in addition to her theatrical animation work, she did radio and comedy records. Here she is doing double duty, playing Little Red Riding Hood and her grandmother on a Stan Freberg record.
I walked up to the cottage, rang the bell.
Come in, dear.
Okay, Grandma, it's a raid.
A raid? Why, I'm just a peace-loving old lady. You've got the wrong grandma.
Yes, ma'am. We just want to get the facts. Where'd you get that bump on your head?
The sky fell on me this morning.
I made a note to book her on the 614 and turned her over to the psychiatrist. I tied her up, put her in the closet, then I put on the grandma's suit and got into bed. Come in, ma'am.
Hello, Grandma. I got the loot. What are you doing in bed?
I'm feeling poorly.
But, Grandma, what big ears you have.
All the better to get the facts. I just want to get the facts, ma'am.
But, Grandma, what a big subpoena you have in your pocket.
All the better to serve you with.
Sometimes she didn't even get credit for doing the voices she did. She was in one of my favorite movies of all time, Jaws, uncredited, dubbing telephone operators and incidental voices that you hear in the background. And, being very tiny and easy on the eyes, she was also a visual model for the mermaids in Disney's Peter Pan. She got to star in a movie, too. The Rocky and Bullwinkle movie was a movie. And while she didn't voice Natasha for the movie, she did give Rene Russo lessons. Also, here's another cool thing June Foray did. Do you love The Twilight Zone? By the way, if you just answered no to that, then congrats. You simultaneously answered the question, can Trevor and I be friends? But One of the creepiest episodes of the series ever was Living Doll, the story about the Talking Tina doll. June was the doll. She did the voice. And it's kind of obvious why she was picked to do it, because Talking Tina in the show was based on a real pull-string talking doll for girls by Mattel called Chatty Cathy. And June voiced her too. So she just did like a devil-possessed version of that voice for Talking Tina.
I got a call to do the Twilight Zone with a Chatty Cathy voice, Talking Tina, who kills Telly Savalas. But she was evil. You know, she was nice to the little girl, but she would always say, my name is Talking Tina, and I'm going to kill you. And in the end, when she does kill him, the wife picks up the doll, and the doll says, my name is Talking Tina, and you better be nice to me.
While the characters they portray are timeless, the problem that can arise for actors who create a voice print for iconic characters such as Granny is that it's not as easy to do what they were once called upon to do. Although June was able to voice the character well into her 90s, her ability to sing as Granny did not follow into the 90s. Sylvester and Tweety Mysteries was produced in 1995, and at the very first recording session with June, she surprised the recording crew with the statement that she absolutely could not sing. This came as a shock, as she is heard singing in more than one classic cartoon.
Whenever a tugboat chugs upstream, you'll always see it puffing out steam. A happy tugboat seems to sing
a toot 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 and a ding ding ding.
Oh, a tugboat whistle goes toot toot toot. It toots high and it toots low, but the toot 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 doesn't mean a hoot. It's a chugga 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 that makes it go.
To the surprise of all in the recording booth, June, indeed, was not confident in carrying a tune that day, and so she was fed the notes to sing on the lines in question by musicians. Whenever voice actors had to do songs for these shows, musicians would be brought in to sing the correct notes for them over their headphones to ensure that the notes were correct. This process took several hours, and the producers were careful not to give June any singing roles in the future. But the thing about this occasion that makes her amazing? Looking at the two singing snippets in the episode in question, you'd never know she couldn't sing anymore.
Here come ladies, sing this song.
Do-da, do-da.
Here come racetrack 5 miles long.
Oh, the do-da day.
Getting a usable take was very difficult and trying for her, something she could do when she was 40 years younger, and yet it doesn't show in this clip. In the mid-90s, pitch correction was not a science, and the easiest thing to do would have been to hire a sound-alike to sing, or a sing-alike, if you will. But June was a consummate professional, and she would not be the reason production was held up, because while the session was a very long afternoon, it would have taken at least another week to audition someone who could sing the songs as Granny, or at least 48 hours for the writers to figure a way around her scripted singing. And on top of that pride and respect for her co-workers, she got the performance.
Buffalo gals, can't you come out tonight? Can't you come out tonight? Can't you come out tonight? Buffalo gals, can't you come out tonight and dance by the light of the moon?
I mean, through that long session, June was the perfect trooper and delivered, of course, a letter-perfect performance. And again, you can't tell that she couldn't hit the notes. In fact, she hits all the notes she sings in this episode, and the same can't be said for Joe Alasky, who did his best Mel Blanc voice recreations of Sylvester and Tweety for the show.
It rained all night the day I left the weather. It was white, the sun so hot it was too dead.
Five more miles of the fabulous song stylings of Pinito Domingo.
Remember that Joe Alasky got started doing Mel's voices for Who Framed Roger Rabbit because Mel could no longer pull off the extremes of Yosemite Sam's voice anymore. So, in that way, June succeeded where Mel did not. At a time when June Foray and Mel Blanc were still active in the business, a lot of people said of her that she was the female Mel Blanc. Chuck Jones is reported to have said of this statement that that is not necessarily true. It's more that Mel Blanc is the male June Foray. By the way, if you are at all a fan of the titans of voice acting today, you know Tara Strong. I'm very familiar with her work, as I am with June's, and yet it wasn't until yesterday doing research for this video that I noticed Tara very closely resembles a young June Foray. at least from the neck up. And as diminutive as June was, Tara's even shorter. But the comparisons don't stop there, because Tara Strong will probably continue working until she can't, and live on to inspire many with her seemingly endless awesomeness. Although, even if I mention every single way that June paved the way as a female voice actor for cartoons, I still wouldn't be including everything she did for animation.
Well, incredible.
What animation has done for me.
Of course.
Indeed, it could be argued, with merit, that no one single person fought harder for animation to be taken seriously as an art form than Miss June Foray. Another thing that a lot of people who have been covering her death haven't really pointed out is that she created the Annie Awards. And in the animation industry, the Annie Awards are basically the Oscars. In fact, having served on the Hollywood branch of the International Animated Film Association, or ASIFA, she fought very hard to get the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences to include an animated feature Oscar category. She was on the Academy's Board of Governors for 26 years, and spent the majority of those years pushing to have the Academy recognize feature animation, which they finally did in 2001. Of course, making all of these contributions to animation, one would correctly assume she'd eventually be awarded an Annie for all she'd done for the industry, which she inevitably was. But she did so under silent protest. After all, the Annie Awards were her creation, and she didn't feel the need to pat herself on the back. In 1965, she told the Los Angeles Times, quote, "Animation has come out of its adolescence. It has grown into a medium for adults. Along with this is the fact that animation has become an art form. It has become an industry filled with people who at one time would have become painters, sculptors, writers for other fields. Animation was once considered a stepchild of the motion picture industry. It has become an industry in its own right." If ever any human was born to do something, June Foray was put on this spinning orb to be the voice print of iconic animated characters and to make a difference in the world of animation. May she now be justly remembered by sundry generations of fans who will love and miss her. Rest in peace, June.